Hello, and welcome to the next module in Waters' Peptide and Protein Bioanalysis Bootcamp. I'm Erin Chambers, Vice President of Chemistry Technology, and today I'd like to talk to you about troubleshooting and optimizing peptide sample prep methods. So some of the things we'll talk about today are the fundamentals of troubleshooting. So some basic calculations aimed at characterizing the methodology so that you know where to start with troubleshooting. We'll also talk about some of the primary causes of low SPE recovery, and then review the primary solutions to those. And we'll use examples to walk through these opportunities. The next thing we'll do is learn a technique for optimizing wash and elution solutions for ultimate specificity. This is something that you may better recognize as a 2D optimization technique. And then finally, I'd like to take the opportunity to work through some of these problems and solutions that we've talked about with real world examples. So today, while we're going to be focusing on troubleshooting sample preparation, you'll notice that this is really just one part of an overall workflow in protein and peptide quantification, which includes things like comparisons of ligand binding assays to LC-MS, LC-MS optimization, choice of signature peptides, digestion, all of which are other modules in the bootcamp. So for today's purposes, we're going to start again with some fundamental calculations aimed at characterizing the methodology. We'll look at specifically troubleshooting recovery, some of the symptoms, challenges, solutions. Then we'll cover the optimization, and finally a few in-depth examples. So let's start with the calculations. So the first calculation that is front and center as the foundation to troubleshooting or optimizing an SPE method is proper calculation of recovery. Now this is an absolute recovery calculation. The important thing is that it decouples recovery from matrix effects, both of which are important to understand as you characterize a method. So this approach is also called the post-extracted spike method. And we're going to create two samples, one where you have a blank matrix that goes through the SPE and you add analytes post-extraction. And the other sample is a sample where the analytes are present in the matrix from the beginning. So let's start with creation of the post-extracted spike sample. You start with blank matrix, you take it through the SPE, and then you add your analytes post-extraction. And that gives your post-extracted spike sample. The other sample is a matrix sample that contains the analytes from the very beginning. You take that through the extraction, you end up with your extracted sample. And in this case, the analytes are obviously in there because they were in there from the beginning. And in order to calculate recovery here, you want to compare the MS response from the extracted sample. So that's like your incurred sample. The analytes are in the matrix from the beginning. Compare that response to the MS response in the post-extracted spike sample. So in that instance, there was no opportunity for analyte loss through the SPE device as they were added post-extraction. So this is critical for the foundation, the proper calculation of recovery. The next calculation is equally as important, and this is the matrix effect calculation. So this will give you a sense of the specificity of your methodology. So again, this really helps you characterize it so that you know where to place your efforts when you're looking to optimize. So here again, we're going to create two samples. The difference between these two samples is that one contains residual matrix, the other is merely a solvent standard. Now, it is important that both have the same concentration of analytes and that they be in the same solvent composition. So your elution solution is what you want to use to create your solvent standard. It's important because you can experience enhancement or suppression from the solvent, so for example, the percent organic or the modifier as well. So in step one, let's create our sample containing matrix. So this is like your post-extracted spike sample from the recovery calculation. Start with blank matrix, take it through the SPE, and add your analytes to the eluate. The second sample is merely blank elution solution to which you add the analytes. They're both the same concentration. Now, in order to calculate matrix effects, what you want to do is you want to compare the MS response of the post-extracted spike sample. So that's in the presence of matrix. You want to divide that by the response in the non-extracted solvent standard, the absence of matrix. Now, if you get a negative value, that indicates that there's suppression. So if the signal is lower in the presence of matrix, there's suppression. If it's higher, that equals enhancement. Now, both are problems that you need to deal with because they can be unpredictable depending on sample, patient to patient, for example. So now let's talk about recovery itself. We've learned how to calculate it. Let's talk about some of the possible problems. And in some cases, we'll be talking about symptoms. We'll talk about the cause and then the solution. So low recovery. So what are some possible causes? So one cause is that you don't have enough capacity. So you may have a small device like a 10 mg cartridge with a large sample volume. So in which case you might need to go up to a higher capacity cartridge. The other thing that's important to note here is that in general, when comparing capacity of traditional SPE devices between small molecules and large molecules, the overall effective capacity is lower for large molecules. This is primarily because of their lower diffusion coefficient. So in fact, they cannot migrate fully into all of the chromatographic pores and are more dependent on the surface of the stationary phase for binding. So this in effect lowers the capacity. And the larger the peptide, the more this appears to be true. This places a high dependence on the flow rate of the load step, where you want to really maximize contact time. Now, this effect gets further magnified if you're dealing with a digest. So in a typical sample for, let's say, an endogenous peptide, you load the sample, most of the high abundance proteins pass through by size exclusion. If, for example, you're doing a protein quantification study and you digest the whole plasma or serum sample, all of those high abundance proteins are now being digested and can retain, effectively decreasing the capacity of the device significantly. You may see low recovery due to poor retention. So if you have a very, very polar compound and you fail to bind it initially upon loading, you may see low recovery. And so one of the solutions there is to ensure that very polar analytes are charged upon loading. You may have seen in one of the basic modules on peptide and protein SPE that we recommend a mixed mode sorbent so that you have the opportunity not only for high specificity, but to bind analytes through ion exchange. Chemical stability can also be a problem where the actual M over Z value changes, and that can look like low recovery. Some of the biggest problems you face with proteins and peptides, however, are related to nonspecific binding or protein binding. We'll talk about those more in a moment. And then finally, when you think about the elution solution, you have to make sure that the analytes are soluble, that it's a strong enough solution, and in some cases, you may be looking at adding some pretty aggressive additives to fully solubilize your proteins or peptides. You also want to make sure the volume is adequate. So let's talk a little bit about each one of these problems and some potential solutions in more detail. So device capacity. One obvious solution is that you load less sample or you increase the bed mass. Another solution is to change the pretreatment. So in some of the examples I talked about, if you were able to do a precipitation prior to SPE, you could eliminate high abundance proteins, effectively increasing your capacity for the analytes of interest. If you have poor retention, again, we talked about the value of binding by ion exchange, both for specificity, but also for very, very polar compounds. If you charge them upon loading and you choose the correct mixed mode sorbent, they will bind by ion exchange immediately, which is a very, very strong binding mechanism. Another possibility for poor retention of analytes is that they're actually bound to plasma proteins and pass right through in the load step. So in that case, you'd want to eliminate protein binding. And we will talk about some options for that shortly. Chemical stability. So there are many known instabilities in amino acids, and they result in known changes in M over Z values. So one of the things that you can do there to dig into this a bit more is to run an MS scan and look for some of these expected mass shifts. Then there's nonspecific binding, and this is absolutely ubiquitous in protein and peptide analyses. When it comes to SPE, ideally you'd eliminate any 100% aqueous samples when you're dealing with stickier peptides, because this will tend to cause a condition where they played out. Another option, again, very, very critical if you're working with solvent standards or low protein content matrices, is to add a carrier protein. And then finally, protein binding. So if your peptide is highly bound to a plasma protein, you may need to use some fairly aggressive measures to disrupt that. So things like denaturation, aggressive organics, or modifiers. So we talked about some of the challenges and how to resolve them. Another thing it's important to do for troubleshooting is to characterize your analyte up front. This actually helps you to be able to predict what types of problems you might encounter. So we talked a little bit about charging the analyte and the sorbent so that you get that initial strong binding upon loading and during the washing. You also need to heavily consider the solubility of these peptides in your elution solution. So this is something that's interesting to discuss if you come from a small molecule background. Small molecule scientists, we all tend to just increase the organic if we want to be sure we get the analyte off the sorbent. When you're talking about peptides or proteins, this can actually result in a situation where you precipitate the peptide. So you want to consider solubility, but you need to keep the organic to really no more than 75% at a maximum. And if you're not getting the elution or the recovery that you're looking for, the next step is actually to add a modifier to improve solubility to fully elute that analyte. Finally, you want to consider the polarity of the analyte. So we talked briefly about whether or not it's polar. If it is very polar, again, you may want to optimize your pretreatment to ensure that ion exchange binding. And if you have a very nonpolar peptide, so one that's characterized by either a high HPLC index, by greater than 50% hydrophobic residues, you're really going to want to look at the elution solvent volume and strength. And when we get to the real world examples, you'll see a very nice story there about elution solution. So other things to consider, we talked about stability and chemical modifications, things like deamidation, oxidation, cyclizing of N-terminal glutamic acids, hydrolysis. So these are very predictable. You know the conditions that cause these. So if you have any of these particular amino acids, methionines and such in the sequence, you'll want to consider modifying your method to eliminate high or low pH extremes. Protein binding, we talked about earlier as a significant issue with peptides and proteins. So things you want to think about are acids, bases, strong acids, denaturants such as guanidine hydrochloride or urea. And one quick way to determine if you have a protein binding method is to compare recovery in a saline solution with carrier protein to a plasma solution. If it's lower in plasma, you likely have a protein binding problem. And then you have nonspecific binding. Always ensure you use carrier protein. So just a quick example, speaking of nonspecific binding, this is an example of an amyloid beta method. It's a very large peptide, very sticky. So it's very common to use solvent standards during method development. And when we did that, the recovery was 60%. We checked the mass balance, so we looked at our elution recovery, our load fractions, wash fractions. We didn't find anything. So some of the possible causes are that the elution solvent is too weak, there's not enough volume, or that we have nonspecific binding. And if you look at the characteristics of this peptide, large, very sticky, the most likely here is nonspecific binding. And once we added carrier protein, you see that the recovery goes right up over 90%. So just another quick example, And in this case, you know, we're going to be looking at a problem with protein binding. So for that same amyloid peptide, high recovery in cerebrospinal fluid, which is a low protein content matrix, and very low recovery in plasma. The major difference there is the protein content. So what can we do? Modify the pretreatment. In this particular case, the only option that actually worked was a full denaturation. So sometimes you need to resort to some sort of extreme measures. So let's talk a little bit more about solubility and an example there. So teriparatide is also a sticky, larger peptide. And when I talk about solubility, I mentioned in elution solutions, you don't want to have too much organic. The same holds true if you're going to do a precipitation pretreatment. If you look at the left of your screen there, at a 1-to-1 organic to plasma ratio, the recovery is pretty good. When you start to use more organic, you see we've lost half of the recovery. This is because you actually start to precipitate the peptide of interest. Additionally, if we look at modifiers, in this case here, if you follow the green arrow, you get better solubility for teriparatide under basic conditions than acidic conditions, resulting in about a 20% increase in recovery. And one final example here, talking about pretreatment. So this was, in fact, an insulin methodology. When we pre-treated the plasma with acid, so that's the middle chromatogram there, we saw a broad peak in the final eluate. We summed it, deconvoluted, and found that we had a lot of human serum albumin in there. Once we changed the pre-treatment to base, you can see that that peak is eliminated. So under basic conditions, HSA passes right through the extraction device upon loading, and you can see that there's nothing left in the final eluate. So we've improved the specificity quite a bit through pretreatment. So let's briefly talk about optimization. And the key here is that you want to discover a condition where you're able to use the strongest wash possible without eluting your analyte, and the weakest elution possible, which still gives you high recovery. So let's look at a couple plots here. So on the left, this is one analyte. And what we've done is taken a variety of different wells, so 10 wells on the left, 10 wells on the right, and we increased the organic percentage of the elution by 10% in each case. And if you look at the graph there, at about 70% organic, you start to elute the compound. So this tells you that you don't want to wash with any more than about 50%. When you look at the remainder of the graph there, you start to see the maximum recovery being achieved at about 90%. So you probably want to go with about 95% for your elution. The example on the right is quite similar. Again, you start to see the analyte coming off the sorbent at 60%. You want to back off a little bit for your wash at, say, about 45%. And then your maximum recovery occurs somewhere around 80%. You want to give a little bit of extra there, so we probably would elute with 90%. So this can be very, very effective at creating a very narrow window of elution around the analyte of interest and ending up with a very, very specific methodology. So in the example here for C-reactive protein, we've digested it. We're looking at recovery for the signature peptides. Here, again, we want to use the minimum amount of organic in the elution possible because we want to leave behind all the hydrophobic interferences. We also want to wash with a certain percentage of aqueous and a very small percentage of organic to eliminate digest reagents and salts. And in this case, we found that 40% organic represented that optimal. So that was C-reactive protein. So the same holds true when we look at a variety of different monoclonal antibodies and look at both unique and generic signature peptides, where we end up with really that optimal being at about 40% organic. So finally, let's just walk through a couple real-world examples here to demonstrate some of what we talked about today. So one of my favorites and some research that I'm very fond of and is close to my heart is Alzheimer research. So we've done quite a bit of work with amyloid beta peptides. These are the peptides that form plaques in the brain and are associated with the progression of Alzheimer's disease. They're very, very difficult to work with, in part because they are large, but primarily because they're extremely sticky and like to aggregate and stick to just about anything and everything they can. So let's look at a method here. So earlier we talked about the importance of carrier protein and solvent standards. When we were developing the method for cerebrospinal fluid, we needed a surrogate matrix. So we started with artificial CSF. And in fact, we saw a high degree of nonspecific binding and needed to add a small amount of carrier protein to better mimic the actual protein content in human CSF and to eliminate nonspecific binding. Furthermore, the protein binding between these very, very sticky peptides that like to aggregate was so significant that the only method of disrupting it was to use a concentrated guanidine hydrochloride solution. And then when it came to elution, we had another challenge. So here are the three amyloid beta peptides. You can see that the first two are recovered quite well out of cerebrospinal fluid, the last not so well. And this is using an elution solution of 65% organic and 5% ammonium hydroxide. It already sounds pretty aggressive. In fact, in order to fully elute that very, very important 1 to 42 isoform, we had to go up to 75% organic. But the real benefit came when we brought the ammonium hydroxide all the way up to 10% to fully solubilize that isoform. And in effect, we were able to accurately and precisely quantify endogenous levels in human CSF. So let's talk now about an insulin methodology. So I mentioned insulin earlier, and in this case, I want to look at optimization. So we had originally developed a method for insulin glargine, or Lantus, and it was using a reversed phase sorbent. And we had an elution solution that was optimized, 60% methanol, 10% acetic acid, good solubility there. We pre-treated with the base, so we eliminated a lot of the HSA. But we were only able to get down to about 200 picogram per mil. And in fact, if you look at the middle chromatogram here, even that might be considered tenuous. So there was a lot of opportunity to optimize. So the optimized methodology involves a protein precipitation, very, very carefully tuned, to eliminate high abundance proteins, followed by the specificity of a mixed mode sorbent. So we were able to bind the insulins by anion exchange. Furthermore, we did a multi-dimensional wash and elution. So we went through the optimization effort. And finally, using less sample than the original method, we were actually able to get that detection limit 4 to 10x, in fact, lower than the original method, using less plasma. And you can see the results here. So finally, I want to wrap it up and talk about some of the primary points that we've covered today. So the first is the importance of identifying and understanding the chemical properties of your peptide. So for example, is it polar? Is it nonpolar? What's the percentage of hydrophobic residues? So some of these characteristics can help you predict the potential problems you may run into. For example, if it's polar, will you run into poor retention? If it's sticky, will you run into nonspecific binding or protein binding? The next, what are the five major challenges you need to worry about? Most of the problems that you experience can be distilled down to five major sources: protein binding, nonspecific binding, solubility, specificity, and stability. Common causes for low recovery are many of the above: nonspecific binding, failure to disrupt protein binding, capacity of the device, strength and volume of the elution solvent, and poor solubility. Either you're starting to get a precipitation or you don't have a high enough concentration of modifier. And then finally, the importance of employing a 2D optimization, where you're going for the strongest wash solution possible, which does not start to elute the analyte, and the weakest elution solution, which still gives you maximum recovery. Lastly, don't be afraid of very aggressive pretreatment or elution solutions for extremely sticky peptides. So I'd like to thank you for attending today's module, and I would invite you to attend future modules in the Waters Peptide and Protein Bioanalysis Bootcamp.